Good afternoon, Chicago. I'm Sasha-Ann Simons, and this is Reset. It's Friday. Yeah, that's right. I said it. That means it's time for our weekly news recap. We'll dive into the biggest local stories that you might have missed, given the big national news I know we all heard this week.
Vice President Kamala Harris has selected Tim Walz as her running mate.
What does today's news mean for Governor Pritzker's political future?
Governor J.B. Pritzker is calling on a downstate Illinois sheriff to quit over his handling of the shooting death of Sonia Massey.
Sonia Massey's family wants real systemic change, and they're calling for it across all parts of government.
And here to help us make sense of it all is a panel of top-notch journalists. Michael Puente, WBEZ Race, Class, and Communities reporter, is here in studio. Hey, Mike.
Hey, good morning.
Kim Bellware is a national and breaking news reporter for The Washington Post. Welcome back, Kim.
Hi, Sasha-Ann.
And Mitch Armantrout covers government and politics for the Chicago Sun-Times. Good to have you back, Mitch.
Thank you so much.
So, Illinois Governor J.B. Pritzker, he didn't end up making the Democratic ticket for the presidential election. Is anybody surprised at the table here today?
I don't think so. I mean, I feel like as far as Kamala Harris's, you know, she's trying to pick up some Midwestern votes. And obviously, Illinois is kind of in the heart of that, but not a battleground state. And, you know, a billionaire on the ticket isn't necessarily something that speaks to sort of middle class voters that she's targeting.
Yeah, I didn't have any hope in that. I just did not think it was going to happen at all. You too, Mike?
No, yeah. You know, I think the thing he did bring was like, you know, deep pockets, obviously. But it takes more. It takes more than that. But he is a popular governor in a state that was underwater in terms of its finances. He turned that around. He's got a very nice demeanor about him. So maybe he would have been good in that terms. But I never really took it, you know, like he was a real serious contender. And no disrespect to him. It just, you know, not a battleground state.
Yeah. What about you, Kim?
Yeah. I mean, he made the short list, but, you know, like Mitch and Michael said, he, you know, wasn't going to bring a lot as far as a lot of votes from a battleground state. Mm-hmm. Not sure what his popularity looks like on a national level. He's been a very effective attack dog and surrogate for the Biden administration and has been a huge fundraiser for them. Really
right.
important for Democratic national politics. But, you know, so much of what my colleagues at the Post had reported on is for Harris, this pick really came down to, you know, vibes, to chemistry. Mm-hmm. And her chemistry with Walz was so instant and really powerful. Mm. And, you know, he is bringing, you know, he has a background from a rural part of the Midwest. You know, he has military service. He has, you know, strong union support. So he was bringing a little more in his saddlebags than Pritzker was to that extent.
Well, you had me at vibes. Because,
mm-hmm.
I mean, that is important. I was going to say earlier, too, that I thought in that short list, Pritzker did, there were folks above him on mm-hmm. the list when as far as a fit for this particular role. But vibes, how we get along, right? We have to work really closely with each other for the next 4 years. That's got to count for something, don't you think, Mitch?
Absolutely. You know, and I feel like Tim Walz is sort of projecting. He's kind of instantly become like a big online meme.
Oh, definitely.
As far as, you know, the dad candidate, he's really leaning into this image as sort of a folksy, you know, just a nice
Seems
person.
Like a respectful guy.
Exactly.
Well,
Midwest nice.
Our fashion critic, I love when they get into politics because they bring such fun insights. But, you know, they noted that Walz looks normal and good and credible wearing a Carhartt jacket. You can't really see Pritzker wearing a Carhartt jacket, you know, really trying to appeal to these, you know, rural voters, to, you know, to farmers and things like that. And he, you know, he's brought that happy warrior vibe. But importantly, he was a former House member. He has a lot of popularity in that chamber that, you know, doesn't feel like it gets a lot of respect. Harris was a senator. Biden was a senator.
Mm-hmm.
Vance is a senator. So having someone who comes from the people's chamber definitely goes a long way. And he also has the history, unlike a lot of the other people on that short list, of effectively reaching across the aisle, which is going to be another big thing.
Yeah, huge. There's been an outpouring of support and really good-natured jokes about the Midwest on mm-hmm. the internet ever since, right? Talk more about some reactions that you guys have all been hearing about this pick of Walz. And if you've noticed this sense of Midwesterner pride now that we're on the big stage.
Just talking to Chicago area voters, I've been spent the last few weeks talking to folks about their thoughts on the race, sort mm-hmm. of taking their temperature heading into November. And One thing about Tim Walz is that he's sort of, you know, he kind of brings this, you know, kind of bipartisan spirit. At least, you know, he's got those connections in Washington. But folks who I talked to, they really weren't familiar with him, and they almost viewed that as a good thing, you know, which is kind of an interesting attitude. It's something that drew a lot of voters to Donald Trump, is, you know, this outsider coming in and, you know, shaking things up.
Yeah, that's true.
And I feel like Walz, he kind of enters the race without much baggage or, you know, preconceived notions from a lot of voters, at least in Illinois. Obviously, he's well-known in Minnesota. And so I think folks are really gravitating towards, you know, all these sort of those dad vibes that they're really projecting right now.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think a lot of people, especially if you look at social media, had their favorite. It was almost like an American Idol competition. If some people want Buttigieg and some people want Josh Shapiro. So there was a little bit of a letdown. Now, if you saw that rally in Pennsylvania where Josh Shapiro was there, he almost looked like he could have outshined Kamala Harris. So maybe they did. Maybe although he was a favorite pick for a lot of people, he looked almost presidential.
A little too much. Yeah, you know what? You bring up a good point there, Mike, because I read that of the people on the short list, like Walz was the one that was people thought was most likely to not speak over.
Right.
Kamala Harris.
Right. Which... Right. And so, but I think initially people had to get over their initial disappointment for whomever they wanted to have as VP. Now they got Tim Walz. They're getting to know him. He speaks like a regular guy. You're right. Midwestern values. A lot of dad jokes. I love dad jokes because I'm a dad. And so he has that folksiness to him. He doesn't seem to say anything that's, I don't know, weird.
It's been a great contrast, too, I think, for Democrats who are excited about this pick, because you had a VP pick in Vance who is someone who is energetic, who is really leaning into their reputation as a Midwesterner. But he has had so much more negative thing. I mean, famously, his book was not very flattering about his, you know, his Midwestern roots. You know, he's talking about the dysfunction of it all. And then, you know, he's had these stints in Silicon Valley and, you know, in private equity. And Walz doesn't have any holdings outside of his National Guard, congressional and teacher pensions. You know, he doesn't speak with Pennsylvania Governor Josh Shapiro's soaring Obama-like rhetoric, but he's very plain-spoken in a way that's still effective. And so he really was kind of cutting that different figure, because Josh Shapiro probably, rhetorically at least, he's going to sound a lot more like Kamala Harris. And you have, you know, we had reported that notably on the Democratic ticket, neither of these candidates have gone to an Ivy League, which is a big departure from a lot of candidates over the years.
Yeah. Donald Trump's painting Walz as too liberal, whereas Harris is hoping that he'll have broad appeal. Is that right?
Yes.
Absolutely, yeah.
And he was behind policies in Minnesota that, you know, obviously Trump and Vance are going to make these look like scary liberal outlier positions, but they proved to be really popular, you know, free lunch for children, for school children, regardless of income, things like that. You know, there's been an attack line against him where they were calling him Tampon Tim because he was making it such that you can get free menstrual products in schools.
That's why I saw that picture online. I wondered the reference.
But, you know, if you talk to any eighth grade girl who, you know, needs some menstrual products at school, they're probably, I mean, they're not voters, but, you know, I don't know that that attack line is going to go over the way that Republicans thought it would.
Exactly. If you're just tuning in, this is Reset. I'm Sasha-Ann Simons. We're going behind the big stories in our weekly news recap with our guests, Kim Bellware, who's national and breaking news reporter for The Washington Post, Mitch Armantrout, who's a Chicago Sun-Times government and politics reporter, and Michael Puente, who's a WBEZ race, class, and communities reporter. Now, Mitch, we're going to turn back to Governor Pritzker, but for a very different story that developed this week. Now, he was calling for the resignation of Sangamon County Sheriff Jack Campbell, saying that he should never have hired that officer who killed Sonia Massey last month. Let's listen.
How did the sheriff end up hiring this person? I mean, no one hires somebody without checking out the hiree's background. And so I have a lot of questions, and I'm so far disappointed with the answers that I'm hearing from the sheriff.
Does Pritzker have authority over that sheriff's department?
He does not. This is an elected sheriff who won pretty resoundingly a little more than a year ago. But I feel like this is, you know, there's not really any other political option for Governor Pritzker to take, a stance on this issue. This is obviously a really, really troubling police shooting that's kind of roiled, it's made national news for the last 3 weeks or so. Mm-hmm. And there's just sort of been this growing drumbeat of local officials in central Illinois calling for this sheriff to step down as a result of hiring this this deputy who's now charged with murder, who had kind of mm-hmm. cycled through a number of jobs before, I believe 6 police jobs in a span of 4 years. Yeah. He's never fired, but, personnel records show that he was not the most glowing example of an employee. So I feel like, Pritzker, he really, you can't take his – the family wants the sheriff to step down.
Yeah.
And, as a Democratic governor – you can't do anything but go along with those wishes. Not to say that Governor Pritzker is not sincere in what he's saying here.
Yeah.
But I feel like this is a position that, he's going to take, and it feels like those calls are growing louder. And the sheriff, for his part, has said he's not going anywhere.
So far, Sheriff Jack Campbell said he's not resigning, right?
Right. He's, in his view, he says that this is, as tumultuous a moment for the office as possible, and it's mm-hmm. no time for turnover. That's obviously up for debate.
So, Kim, new sheriff's reports were released this week, including an account that the officer who killed Massey, who's Sean Grayson, he claims that he was fearing for his life. I don't know if you saw that, but the sheriff's office concluded that Grayson's use of force was inappropriate. Is there any evidence to support Grayson's claim? I mean, you watched the video.
Yeah.
As I did.
So these reports that were released came from Grayson himself. These were the written reports after the incident. And they also included the reactions from other officers who responded as, to the call of shots fired. So you had, I think, about 9 different perspectives in there. Grayson's was the longest. And this is the first time, we saw how he was framing the narrative of the shooting in the immediate aftermath mm-hmm. and what he said on, what he said in his report about fearing for his life. He described Massey as hoisting this pot of unknown liquid, where he had also identified it as water at a different point, but hoisting this pot of liquid overhead and, about to throw it at him, and that, he feared for his life. But that is really in conflict with what we saw from the body camera footage of his partner who was with him. And the most important thing is that Massey was unarmed in all of this.
Right.
But, the sequence of events, doesn't line up from the video to his report. And, the other thing that had made, had drawn some attention is she's heard on the video saying, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
And he wrote that I interpreted that to mean that she intended to kill me.
Right.
And some people pointed out that either seems to be a bit of a stretch, or it does reveal maybe a lack of cultural competency. That's, anybody who's familiar, maybe with, church-going people.
Christianity.
Especially Black church-going people. Mm-hmm. That's usually not a signal.
It doesn't mean I'm going to kill you.
Yeah.
Yeah. I can clear that up today.
But a lot of inconsistencies in that report. And notably, inaccurate reporting is something that had been flagged by his superiors at previous jobs. As Mitch mentioned, he had been employed at a lot of places. And at one point in one of these personnel files that Sangamon County released, he has an interview with a superior about an incident where he didn't call off a high-speed chase. And this is a really contentious interview where, basically a superior officer is calling his integrity into question. And so at least the accuracy of his reports has been noted in his record in the past.
Yeah. Mike, you guest hosted Reset earlier this week. Thank you again.
You're welcome.
In that time, you spoke with Sharon Fairley, who's former head of the Civilian Office of Police Accountability. Now, she said it's true that there was nothing in Grayson's file that would have warranted an automatic decertification. But she read that in a former position, his supervisor questioned whether his inaccuracies were mistakes or flat-out lies. Now, she said this did not make it into the hiring process in Sangamon County and that there are possible reasons for that. Let's listen.
Supervisors at law enforcement agencies know that when you say an officer has lied, that's a career killer, right? Game over. Their law enforcement career is over. So mm-hmm. sometimes they may be hesitant to make that kind of finding unless they're really, really, really sure that the person was actually lying and not just mistaken.
So is there a bigger issue here, like about where an agency's priorities are when they're making decisions about what goes into an officer's file?
Well, yeah, there should be, and there should be safeguards. In fact, the new Safety Act should have addressed this. And what I find somewhat surprising in that, okay, the governor, J.B. Pritzker, is asking the Sangamon County Sheriff to resign. There's really not much else you can do because despite the outcry, and this is an international story, a lot of outrage out there, but state lawmakers in Illinois they're not thinking about reform. They're not thinking about what else can we do to prevent this? What new laws or safeguards can we do? You know, according to the reporting of our own WBEZ State House reporter, Mawa Iqbal, state lawmakers are reluctant to pass any new legislation. They want to see what's in state law now to prevent this. The Safety Act should have enough safeguards in there that should have prevented something like this from Sean Grayson jumping from, you know, department to department. It didn't, and it should have prevented this. So, you know, what's keeping lawmakers? I kind of feel like there's enough outcry out there that it's going to force the hand of the State House to try to do something.
Yeah, there was a vigil outside of Massey's home this week as the family mourned 1 month since her death. This is Tommy, who's Massey's uncle, speaking at the vigil.
We need to bring all that love together and turn this negative thing into something positive for us to hold on and you know, just hope that justice will prevail.
So, yeah, in this search for justice, Massey's father is calling for a bill that would address the so-called wandering officer problem, as you mentioned there, Mike. Mm-hmm. This is where they can bounce from department to department. There is current legislation, though, that automatically decertifies officers for misconduct so that they can't get another job in Illinois. But so far, no one's been automatically decertified. I mean, what's going on?
I sort of took Sharon Fairley's analysis of that to mean that it is such a, like she said, it's a career killer that people are reluctant to, you know, pull that lever unless it's a really, really egregious case. And in some cases, it might be just easier to move them on than to pull that lever.
And so we're clear, what do we know so far about the charges that Grayson's facing right now, Kim?
So he is facing murder charges. He remains in custody. And Mitch, do you know when that next court appearance is? Miguel, I don't know if that...
I don't know exactly when the next court appearance is on that.
All right, we'll take a pause here. Kim Bellware is a national and breaking news reporter for The Washington Post. Mitch Armantrout is a government and politics reporter for the Chicago Sun-Times. And WBEZ reporter Michael Puente is here. They're going to stick around. We hope that you do, too. The Olympics are nearly over, rather, but here's Claire Lane with an update.
Yes, we're nearly there. The final days of the competition at the Summer Olympics are underway in Paris. The closing ceremony is actually coming up on Sunday. Today, certainly a busy day on the track. Several finals, including the men and women's 4x100-meter relays, as well as the U.S. women's basketball team. They're taking on Australia in a semifinal game. So be sure to stay with us on 91.5 for the latest updates from the games from NPR News. Here at home, the last piping plover at Montrose Beach has flown south for the winter. Nagamo was the lone surviving chick of parents Imani and Sea Rocket. Nagamo's parents flew south just days before. The chick was on Montrose for 38 days. And area birders say they watched him with, quote, joy, wonder, anticipation, and even some anxiety. And later today on Here and Now, mortgage rates, believe it or not, have dropped to their lowest level in about 15 months. A bright spot in a tumultuous week for the financial markets. We'll get the latest on the housing market. That's after 2 o'clock. More Reset continues next. Stay with us.
WBEZ is supported by the Alzheimer's Association. The Chicago Walk to End Alzheimer's on September 21st supports research and care of those affected by dementia. Participants of all ages are welcome. alz.org/walk.
WBEZ is also supported by the Obama Foundation, with a mission to inspire, empower, and connect people to change the world. Learn how to help their efforts at obama.org.
When you tune into WBEZ, you're doing more than just listening. You're expanding your horizons with stories from across the street and around the world. By becoming a new member today, you'll be part of something bigger, a community that supports in-depth reporting. You're investing in stories that bring us together and help us understand our world. Your support matters more than ever in keeping Chicagoland connected and informed. Join our community of members today at WBEZ.org/donate.
And you're invited to join WBEZ for an evening of laughter. This will be Wednesday night, August 21st. Not From Here features Chicago comedian Anji Kim and guests sharing some hilarious stories of growing up in immigrant families. You'll find out more at WBEZ.org/events. Going to be a pretty nice day, actually. Lots of sun into the early afternoon. Going to see some clouds later. Otherwise, highs in the upper 70s. Clear tonight with lows in the 50s. Right now, we've got 73 degrees near Midway. At 1226, this is WBEZ.
This is Reset. I'm Sasha-Ann Simons, and we're back now with more of our weekly news recap. Before the break, we took a close look at why Governor Pritzker got passed over for the Democratic VP pick, as well as his call for a downstate sheriff to step down over his handling of the police killing of Sonia Massey. But we have still got a lot of news to cover.
A federal lawsuit filed today on behalf of Venezuelan migrants trying to find work in Chicago.
It alleges physical abuse at the hands of security guards at retail giant Home Depot.
Governor Pritzker signed the bill, which simplifies the process for people released from prisons and jails to obtain a state ID card.
The Chicago White Sox let go of their manager, Pedro Grifol.
After 21 L's in a row, the White Sox come to the West Coast and get their first win in a long time.
Long time. Our panel today is Kim Bellware, national and breaking news reporter for The Washington Post, Mitch Armantrout, Chicago Sun-Times government and politics reporter, and Michael Puente, WBEZ reporter and Sunday anchor. All right, so I hope some folks who are listening to us right now are baseball fans, because the White Sox have had a pretty eventful week. We're going to turn to the team leadership updates in just a second, but first, let's just take a moment. Let's sit with this. Let's give the Sox their flowers, folks. The team finally broke its 21-game losing streak. They beat the Oakland A's 5-1 this week. I mean, were you relieved, Mike?
Yes, absolutely. I felt like, look, I'm a reporter here. Yeah, I got to be fair and balanced. But I'm a Sox fan. I've been a Sox fan.
Yeah, we know.
Since the 70s, I was going to come in here with my Sox jersey. Look, I'm going to take kind of responsibility for Pedro Grifol getting fired, because just on Wednesday when I was hosting, I asked Sherry Style,
yeah,
how does this guy still have a job? The Sox aren't just, I'm a Sox fan. I know bad Sox teams, but this is beyond a bad season. This is historically bad. So I just felt for the sense of accountability. You can't have a manager there allowed to have two 15-plus, you know, losing streaks. So now they got, you know, Grady Sizemore in there now. We're 1-1 over the last two games. We're playing against the Cubs this weekend. So go Sox, yeah. New attitude, new beginnings, hopefully.
Okay, any excitement over here about the win?
I think we are all actually Sox fans again. You know, reporter caveat
yes, everyone.
But I haven't been paying close attention because it was just too tough of a slog. I don't think I have Mike's dedication to really ride out some of the really, really tough stuff. But, you know, it was inescapable. You would go online and you're like, how's my team doing? And then you hear somebody say their losing streak has reached drinking age. But, you know, they've hit 21. And that's never, you know, nobody who's in the Sox world. That's not the kind of chatter you want to see about your record.
It's pretty terrible.
See, I almost got a perverse joy out of it just because we know this team is awful. And I figure if you're going to be awful, just go for it. But it really can't be overstated. Just like it was almost like a time warp with this losing streak. I looked back before they won this week. Their last win came 3 days before the assassination attempt on Donald Trump. Like the world has literally changed so much in that time.
Oh my goodness!
Yeah.
When you put it that way. Yeah. But so, Mike, let's get back to what you alluded to earlier, right? Pedro Grifol, like, what was the reason? Like, what's the real reason here for 21 losses? I mean, I brought my kid to a game as well, and it was quite embarrassing. We got smoked.
Look, Sasha, there's no question that he got a bad hand dealt to him. No question about that. They traded off some of their best players, things that just have not worked out. Look, I put all this on Jerry Reinsdorf, the owner. Things started going downhill when they hired Tony La Russa as the new manager. Tony La Russa was great in the 80s, not so much now. I think it's becoming very sour because this was supposed to be our time. We had a team built to win, And slowly but surely, a lot of those building blocks have been taken away. So players that, you know, we like Aloy, we were supposed to get up there and help us win. It just didn't turn out that way, and they're removing. But on the other hand, when he signed up to be a Major League Baseball manager, you've got to come with solutions. You gotta figure out a way to win.
But is this losing streak his fault though?
Yeah, part of it is. Yeah, absolutely, because he would bring in a certain you know, relievers into the game when he shouldn't have.
Yeah.
The team should not be that poorly in the field. The fundamentals, people not running out just ground balls. No, it partly is his fault.
It's business as usual. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing in the NBA, in the NHL. If the team's losing, bye-bye, coach.
I take the analogy of that. Look, Justin Fields, great talent. Everybody said, hey, this guy is going to be our future. He just lost too much. He lost too many games. And no matter what the people are telling you around, hey, it's not your fault, we're going to get better. It comes down to your fault. You've got to win. And the bottom line is, you got to win.
So that said, Mitch, some people might be wondering, why did it take so long to let him go?
I think there's probably, it's hard to say, just because the organization is so poorly run and it's been so poorly run for so long. I think, you know, especially, I also have to say, like, White Sox fans are pretty dour in general just because of how bad things have been for the last few decades. Yeah. But, Mike, you're one of the more positive Sox fans that I know. And to hear his, you know, just real misery in this,
Mike,
it just goes to
positive.
Say.
Mike, should I out one of your tweets?
No. That's when I'm at home. When I'm at home and I'm just, you know, relaxing, I'm as negative as they come.
I said, poor White Sox. Look at these tweets. Mike is upset.
It says a lot that players who escape this organization pretty quickly find success elsewhere. The White Sox traded off Eloy Jimenez, who arguably one of the biggest busts of this rebuild. He goes to the Orioles. He's hitting like Frank Thomas in his prime.
Yeah.
Michael Kopech, another reliever who really struggled here, didn't meet expectations. He's in L.A., doing great. So there's something is rotten at 35th and Shields.
Jeez. And so, as Mike mentioned earlier, Grady Sizemore is here, right? This is a temporary manager in the time being.
Right.
Definitely ahead of this weekend's big crosstown classic game that we've got going on. So is the goal here just finish the season as best as possible and regroup for next season? Or somehow are we trying to turn this season around?
No, there's no turning this season around. In fact,
it's over.
It is over. It's getting, you know, let somebody, you know, Grady's trying to become a manager, give him a little, you know, get his feet wet in there. He's a former player for the Cleveland Indians at the time. Now the Guardians, let him, you know, try it out for a little bit, but then, Chris Getz is the new general manager for the Sox. You know, he gets this hire, you know, try to make it right and try to get somebody in there. I mean, you want somebody with experience, but, you know, we don't want, you know, Tony La Russa back in there, which I heard there's talk. But a lot of the fan favorites still look at A.J. Pierzynski, who was a catcher on the World Series team in 2005. He could be a candidate. And people still love Ozzie Guillen, who was the manager, who feels that he could turn this team around. But Ozzie's old school. He's just, I think he may be a little bit too much for players nowadays, and he's too outspoken. So
yeah,
I'm not sure the Sox would go to him, but they got to get somebody in there who has credibility, not only with the players, but with the fans.
Yeah. Well, changing of the guards now, Kim, I mean, does this give you some hope? Are you still going to check out games?
Yes. I mean, like, now I have a, you know, reason, because if you listen to it on the radio, it just, you know, you like pop your head up every now and again. You're like, oh, so, you know, you don't want to just groan your way through a game.
And I'll still take the free CPS tickets. I'll still bring my kids. No problem. This is Reset. I'm Sasha-Ann Simons. You are tuned into our weekly news recap with Kim Bellware, who's a national and breaking news reporter for The Washington Post, Mitch Armantrout, who's a Chicago Sun-Times government and politics reporter, and Michael Puente, who's a WBEZ reporter and Sunday anchor. So, Mitch, on Tuesday, Governor Pritzker signed a bill that streamlines the process of getting IDs after you get out of prison. So what exactly does the new law do?
So basically, it just cuts through a lot of the red tape for folks who are on their way out of prison or jail. As it stands, people who are incarcerated, they need to have physical copies of their Social Security card and other documents that, you know, sometimes you just don't have it handy, and it's really hard to get them when you're locked up. What this does for folks who have previously had an Illinois ID, basically they can automatically renew through the Secretary of State's office, and they can have that ID ready for them when they are released from custody.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that's something that a lot of folks take for granted, you know, having all your paperwork in order and IDs. But,
yeah.
You know, it's the most basic thing you need to apply for housing, for school, for work programs.
For everything.
And, you know, talking to advocates, it's one of the biggest roadblocks for folks trying to, you know, build a foundation in civilian life.
Why have there been barriers to getting an ID in the first place, given that we use them for so many things?
Right. You know, I think this is like legislation that a lot of Illinois officials have been pushing for a long time. There are similar programs in, frankly, much more conservative states, Florida, Oklahoma, states there where you wouldn't necessarily expect them to be having a, you know, more forward-thinking criminal justice laws. So, yeah, for the sponsors of this bill, including Justin Slaughter from Chicago in the Illinois House, you know, this is something that they've been trying to get across the finish line for a long time. There was a test pilot program earlier this year at
Yes.
the Cook County Jail that several dozen folks took advantage of. And, you know, talking to Alexi Janulius, the Secretary of State, they're hoping to see that number increase by a lot, because this is going to apply at federal penitentiaries, state and county prisons.
Yeah.
So we'll see how many more folks it can help out.
Sure. Kim, let's turn to an alarming story that we saw in City Bureau. This is about the treatment of migrant day laborers. Now, a federal lawsuit's been filed on behalf of five Venezuelans and Colombians who say that they were beaten and harassed by security officers at a Home Depot on the city's southwest side. Now, the suit names two off-duty CPD officers. And among other things, the suit alleges that the guards interfered with their right to seek work. So this is just the latest in the difficulties that many people have had in finding a way to support themselves while they're here. Did you see the story?
Yeah. So this 46-page federal lawsuit that was filed Tuesday is kind of bringing to the fore a lot of the issues that we're seeing with newly arrived migrants seeking work, with allegedly selective enforcement of trespassing laws, and also with what the response is by either private security, which in this case was CPD officers moonlighting, or from, you know, CPD, you know, sheriffs, other law enforcement, just kind of what their interactions have been. Have they been lawful? Have they been respectful? Have they been violent? You know, so this lawsuit was detailing some really disturbing claims, including that these asylum seekers who said they were outside the Home Depot, you know, just trying to pick up work so they can pay, you know, pay their rent, they can take care of their families. You know, they were getting harassed by Home Depot security employees, and that these CPD officers, when they were brought inside to a Home Depot security room, you know, they were making allegations of being shoved, of being choked, of being, you know, punched in the stomach, punched in the ribs.
After they were handcuffed?
After they were handcuffed. And, you know, it was just one man even tried to say that, you know, he's like, I'm Colombian. And they were saying, no, you're Venezuelan. And they felt that there was a lot of targeting going on because they noted there are older day laborers, you know, Mexican day laborers, for instance, that, you know, they weren't getting bothered. So they felt that a lot of this is really targeting people who seem more identifiable as young men, as new arrivals, kind of people who are being profiled as migrants and are being singled out for treatment. And that, you know, the trespassing rules, which, you know, can, they're a misdemeanor. You can, you know, spend some time in jail for that. It's a $1,500 fine. That, you know, that is not enforced all that often. And, you know, that is a little bit confusing because most people, when they go to a Home Depot parking lot, you know, they're not really, that feels public. And
yeah.
So, you know, there's also some contention over if these no trespassing signs, which in Illinois constitute kind of the first warning, you know, are those placed in places that, you know, it's fair. These people were saying, you know, we weren't disturbing, you know, walkways. We weren't, you know, kind of doing anything that seemed illegal. And why was it met with this really outsized
kind of force?
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. And you know what? There was concern, Mitch, I believe in past recaps we've talked about this. There was concern that we would see an influx of migrants bust here to Chicago ahead of the DNC. So far, that hasn't been the case, right?
Right. It's kind of surprising. Yeah, that's kind of been the expectation for months and months, you know.
That we saw that drop, but then it's going to come in August.
Exactly. Like last fall, I believe the number of folks in city shelters from Venezuela was upwards of 12,000, I want to say. And currently that number has been floating around 5,000 for the last month or so, you know, well below the capacity of the shelters that have been set up by the city. Here we are about a week out from the convention starting, and, you know, no indications yet that Texas Governor Greg Abbott has, 15,000 migrants ready to come this way. I think part of that is that border crossings have gone down in recent months. The Biden administration has sort of, stepped up enforcement of, just not allowing more folks in to seek asylum. Hopefully, we'll see if there is a major influx, but at this point, it would
we're getting very close. Yeah. We'll take a pause here. That is Chicago Sun-Times' Mitch Armantrout, WBEZ's Michael Puente, and The Washington Post's Kim Bellware. There's more news to cover just ahead, but first, we'll get an update from the campaign trail. Here's Claire Lane again.
Yes, Vice President Kamala Harris and her running mate are campaigning in Arizona. This is the latest stop on their tour of some battleground states. The Arizona swing is especially significant because Harris passed over the state's junior senator, Mark Kelly, in favor of Minnesota Governor Tim Walz to be her running mate. That may cost her a handful of votes in a state that President Joe Biden won by fewer than 11,000 votes in 2020. But the state is also chock full of Midwesterners who may warm to Walz. And Democrats say the same energy that's greeted Harris at some earlier stops on her battleground tour is still present in Arizona. So certainly details on that, more to come from the campaign trail throughout the day and throughout the weekend here on 91.5. Looking abroad, a new report from Microsoft finds that Iran is accelerating some online activity that appears intended to influence the U.S. election. Today's report finds that Iranian actors have recently created some fake news sites, impersonated activists, and in one case targeted a U.S. presidential campaign official with an email phishing attack. So I have the latest on that story during Here and Now after 2 o'clock. More of Reset continues next. Stay with us.
Later today on This American Life. So Cameron's in the ocean, and he hears, from maybe 100 yards away, someone yelling shark.
There was really three options. You sit there and panic and scream for somebody else to help and you don't do anything. Or you swim the opposite way and try to protect yourself.
Or the third option, you swim toward the shark. That's what Cameron did. What goes through your head when you make that choice later today? It's tonight at 7, tomorrow at noon on WBEZ.
WBEZ is supported by MedGlobal, a Chicago-based medical charity, providing life-saving health care and responding to humanitarian crises around the world with medical teams and supplies. Learn how to help their efforts at medglobal.org.
I'm Peter Sagal. This week's news quiz will feature musicians Jason Isbell and Patti LuPone, plus the song stylings of one Rachel Maddow. Join us for the news quiz from NPR. Saturday at 10, and again Sunday morning at 11 on WBEZ.
Looking at sports, it is another Crosstown Classic weekend in Chicago, this time on the South Side. They'll have the Cubs tonight, first pitch at 7:10. And it's going to be decent weather for it, sunny, some afternoon clouds, highs today in the upper 70s. Right now we've got 71 at O'Hare at 12:44. This is WBEZ.
This is Reset. I'm Sasha-Ann Simons. And if you're just joining us, we're in the home stretch of our weekly news recap. Before the break, we broke down a new bill that would make it easier for those leaving Illinois prisons to obtain state ID cards. Plus, we discussed White Sox manager Pedro Grifol being dismissed after the team finally broke its 21-game losing streak. But we still got a few more stories to get to, and we're going to speed through some lighter news that you may have missed this week. With me are Kim Bellware, who's a national and breaking news reporter for The Washington Post, Mitch Armantrout, Chicago Sun-Times government and politics reporter, and Michael Puente, WBEZ race, class, and communities reporter. All right, so let's start with some transit news in Chicago. The CTA has finally opened the Damon Green Line station. This is after 7 years of construction. It's seen as part of the city's commitment to make resources from the DNC actually benefit the West Side. Right, Mitch?
Yeah, I talked to John Roberson, who's one of the city officials who's sort of spearheading infrastructure efforts for the city in preparation for the DNC. And yeah, some of those dollars that came from the federal government helped finish this project sooner. It's kind of surprising that we haven't had a Green Line stop there. When you think, I mean, just it's a really booming part of the city right there near
right.
West Side, close to the United Center, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of office buildings around there.
And it's great when there's more transit, but I mean, to that point, it also makes you wonder, so would we have gotten this if there wasn't a DNC?
I mean, the joke going around at work for us was that, you know, no, when Joe Biden was still the, you know, candidate, there was no way he's going to go to a DNC and not have a great train in the background. So, you know,
that is true. And is this the place, too, where a station is most needed? That's another question. Right.
I mean, I it's funny. I didn't know for the beginning of construction that it was for a Green Line stop because I just knew that I couldn't get through. I'd bike through there all the way.
Mm-hmm.
And the pink line at Ashland, that's a really busy spot, you know, during Pitchfork, things like that. And then, you know, it is kind of weird that there was never something that was close to the United Center.
Right. That's near where you live, right? The West Side?
Yeah, on the West Side.
Yeah.
So I'm close. I'm further west, but, you know, I'm interested in just seeing what that does to, you know, people taking it from Damon going further west.
Yeah.
Or, you know, because Greenland's a good line. I'm happy. They're always happy to get another stop in there. But, it's. Did there used to be a Green Line stop there back in the day, back?
Not that I've heard of. On a different map. No, not that I've heard of. But we shall see. Sounds like a win for lots of people, for sure. But in not so good news, 30% of the CTA stations are inaccessible to riders with disabilities. So the Sun-Times actually reports that the CTA hasn't installed a single elevator in 5 years. Yeah. And that some stations actually won't be updated until, get this, the year 2038.
Whoa.
Yeah, and if you've ever traveled on the CTA, I mean, this is no surprise to you. You've come across the fact that it's very common that, you know, existing elevators are out of commission or there's no elevator at all, which is quite wild. So, I mean, how are people with disabilities supposed to get around?
Well, that's a good question. And I mean, I think this highlights still sometimes the continued failures of Dorval Carter at the CTA. They're supposed to be on top of this. They have these meetings, these long meetings, talking about the status of CTA. And I know a lot of things cost money. Things can't be done overnight, but it's going to take, another 15 years to get some of these accessible. That's unconscionable. People have to get around. They need to access these stations, and for it to be this long and not have 30 stations, it's really unacceptable.
Yeah, like 14 more years for elevators just sounds incredibly wild to me. Like, why isn't the city prioritizing this?
It's pretty baffling because when you think about the ridership challenges that the CTA has had, they've remained worse on the train, you know, on the L than on buses. And, you know, if you want people to ride it, you know, you do need to be accessible, and accessibility helps not just people with disabilities, but, you know, people who maybe have strollers. You know, I can imagine if you have a family and you have a kid, you know, with strollers,
let alone two,
you know, the idea, you know, just the how much more you would use this service. You know, think about the alternative of paying for parking or doing a rideshare or something like that. If you could hop on the train and get, you know, downtown or get to another neighborhood, that'd be great. But if you are juggling kids and a stroller and there's no elevator, no way.
Yeah. Well, a CTA spokesperson tells the Sun-Times that, quote, funding has been and remains the biggest challenge.
And that's not going to get any easier because, I mean, all the transit agencies in the Chicago area are facing a fiscal cliff next year, upwards of $800 million, I believe, as federal COVID funds dry up. It's tough to see. I mean, you know, obviously the CTA doesn't have a great track record of meeting deadlines, and if their own deadline is 14 years from now, kind of shudder to think when it might actually
and
come
they're
together.
Rarely I mean they're rarely on time, and that applies to many both projects and service.
You just had to twist the knife, didn't you, Kim? what else are they doing wrong over there? All right, let's move to a different kind of transit. Greyhound may be booted from its West Loop station when the lease is up in October. Greyhound's been losing stations with indoor accommodations across the country. I mean, can you imagine this city without a Greyhound station, folks?
No, and I can't imagine waiting for a greyhound without an indoor shelter or someplace that has a bathroom.
Yeah, let's talk about it. Have you folks taken greyhound before?
It's
Mike,
been a while.
Mitch?
Not me.
Not recently, but I've definitely taken one.
And, yes.
You know, also just that, you know, where the station is, you know, that's a place you want to be indoors, like whether it's inclement weather or if just things are feeling a little hairy outside. You know, I'd like to be indoors.
Yeah, well, if Greyhound is evicted from its current station, yeah, this would force passengers to do that curbside service. Now, I've done that before. I mean, any Megabus riders? I know you haven't done Greyhound. Have you done Megabus?
Old school
Probably
Megabus,
not.
Yeah.
Old school Megabus.
Yeah, I did get one of those
and
dollar
other
fares.
Lines. Or the other lines that take you from D.C. to New York, for instance, right?
Yeah.
I've taken a lot of those from curbside in Chinatown, D.C.'s Chinatown. But doing a layover on the curb?
Yeah.
Can you imagine that?
Not doing that.
That's going to make it, you know. And I mean,
Mike's like, no way.
No.
At a time that, you know, municipalities you really hope would step up and make intercity transit, you know, just more functional, more comfortable. This is pretty disappointing. And we also saw that after, was it that Greyhound sold? They sold to new operators and, you know, so different stops are losing their lease. When that's happened and people have relocated to do curbside, then they've often been forced out of those new spots because complaints from residents or local businesses that don't want, you know, a busload's worth of people and luggage,
exactly.
You know, crowding on a sidewalk, which that just presents a lot of logistical and safety issues, too.
Exactly. Yeah, well, the Chicago Sun-Times reports that the city so far hasn't offered a viable alternative that has an indoor space for people to wait and time to figure it out. Well, it is ticking. Now, we can't talk about buses this week, folks, without talking about the Dave Matthews Band tour bus incident. It's been 20 years since the poop incident. And then for those who may have forgotten, would you be so kind, Kim, as to remind us what happened?
20 years ago, the Dave Matthews Band was crossing over the Kinzie Street Bridge when their bus driver opened the hatch to the toilet tank, and
oh my goodness,
and it was going over the bus. You know, that anybody who's gone over that, you know, bascule bridge, it is slatted, so all of that sludge would have gone into the Chicago River were it not for the fact that there was a Chicago Architecture Foundation boat full of people, including, I think, a former Chicago Tribune reporter who was on the boat and
got doused
in it. And, I mean, just...
In
poop water. And just, you know, people thought they were getting splashed by just water until the smell. I mean, one person had their mouth open. I mean, it's terrible. It's terrible. I know we can't say so much on the radio. And it's terrible.
Sorry, folks.
But it's one of those things that, like, you know, I mean, that just made Dave Matthews Band, like, band non grata in town for a long time. And they have cleaned up their, I think, reputation in relation to the incident because, you know, they had to pay the fine. Definitely, I think, the bus driver, you know, like that guy kind of really, he was in trouble. But, you know, they have donated, I think they donated $50,000 to river cleanup activities. And, you know, Chicago River, I'm not saying it's all Dave Matthews Band, but it is cleaner 20 years on than it was.
I mean, do you too, Mitch and Mike, do you remember this,
oh,
this
absolutely.
News day?
Yeah,
oh, yeah,
it was a terrible incident. I don't want to get into the gutter on this, but let's just say
it was
bad.
Terrible for the people on that bus. Just so absurd, you can't help but laugh. I feel like Chicago's obsessed with this story.
My colleague Mitch Dudek wrote a really fun, or horrifying, depending on how you look at it, retrospective. He talked to several people who were on the boat. And one image that has really just stuck with me all week is this person who was on the boat with their motorcycle helmet. And he described it afterwards as like having a bowl of soup in his lap, horrifying. But it's kind of funny, too, how this incident has really picked up sort of a new life on the internet. You know, it's really people, I mean, around the world are just really having a ball with this.
Well, I just learned about it this year.
It's one of those
from
things,
the internet.
It's one of those things that at the time it was very much a Chicago story. And then it kind of widened out, you know, as the internet and social media picks up more. And also it sort of coincided with, you know, Dave Matthews Band is not a musical act that had been talked about as much. You know,
right.
They were getting a little quieter kind of in the mid-aughts. And he's been in the news again. And just, you know, just the internet doesn't forget. And, mm-hmm. and now that this stuff is being resurfaced, I mean, there was a fundraiser at the Hideout. There was, you know, I don't know if there was ever some documentary. And this is all to say that
I'm going to go look for it.
While it's funny, while it's funny in an awful, cringy way to laugh about now, I will say that if I were one of the people who got that stuff dumped on me, 20 years later, I still might not find it funny. So if anybody who was affected by, I mean, the Chicago River, Friends of the Chicago River.
I don't think I'd ever admit
it. They don't find it funny.
I was one of those people. I just would never tell you. You would never know.
Yeah.
Now I want to quickly turn to a music artist making new Midwestern history. Lollapalooza organizers say that Chapel Roan, also known as the Midwest Princess, drew in one of the largest daytime crowds that the festival's ever seen. Is this the year for the Midwest?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Why not?
Right? Dave Matthews Band, Tim Walz.
Tim Walz. Yeah.
Chapel Roan,
like Tim Walz, kind of coming out of nowhere. And
all together. Never thought I'd talk about all three in in one news day. Oh, my gosh. Now, the Bud Billiken Parade is back this weekend for its 95th year. Anybody ever been or going this weekend?
Yes. I mean,
I've covered it in the past, and it's just a fun time.
I loved it. I went 2 years ago for the first time ever with that one daughter of mine, and we had a blast. And sadly, they're heading out of town this weekend, so they can't go. But it was so much fun. It was just so vibrant. Everyone was just so nice and just so welcoming, and it was just great. Lots to see, lots to look at. It's just fantastic.
100% recommend anybody, like, if you've never been.
10 out of 10.
10 out of 10. If you've never been, or if you're new to Chicago, this is a great way to see really, you know, community-based groups. You know, you get to see dancers. Maybe you'll see some Jesse White tumblers.
Yes.
You know, you'll just see a really, just a great vibe, and especially, you know, just for the South Side, which, you know, you want to see that.
Shout out to the South Side. Mm-hmm. Well, the parade's tomorrow. It starts at 10 a.m. at 29th Street and South King Drive. Parking spots are limited, so organizers advise that you carpool or take public transit. The green line's your best bet. Hey, Kim.
Yeah.
But you can also take the red line or the 47 bus. Big thanks to Kim Bellware of the Washington Post, Mitch Armantrout of the Chicago Sun-Times, and WBEZ's Michael Puente. Have a great weekend.
Thank you. Thanks for having us. This is fun.
And that's it for Reset. Yeah, you hear it. The show is produced by Meha Ahmed, Linnea Dominic, Ari Mejia, Micah Yason, Andrea Guthman, Max Lubers, and Ellie Gilbert Bear. Dan Tucker's our executive producer. Evan Schwab, Maria Lopez, and Haley Bloomquist were our engineers this week. I'm Sasha-Ann Simons. Thanks for listening. Have a great weekend, and we'll meet again soon.